இப்போ சரியா இருக்கா? ஃபுல்லா இருக்கா?
ஃபுல் ஸ்க்ரீன் கொடுங்க. ஓகே,
இப்போ சரியா இருக்கா?
இப்போ சரியா இருக்கு.
ஓகே, வி வில் ஸ்டார்ட் நவ். திஸ் இஸ் த லெக்சர் நம்பர் 6 ஆன் கார்பன் டை ஆக்சைட் டு கெமிக்கல்ஸ் அண்ட் ஃபியூயல்ஸ். திஸ் இஸ் கோயிங் டு பி அ ஸ்மால் இன்ட்ரோடக்ஷன் டு CO2 ரிஃபார்மிங் டு ப்ரொடியூஸ் கெமிக்கல்ஸ் வித் மீத்தேன். ஓகே, அ ப்ரீஃப் இன்ட்ரோடக்ஷன் டு CO2 reforming of methane. Now there are few points that we have to know about this. One of them is the focus of this lecture will be mainly dealing with the reforming of carbon dioxide with methane for the production of synthesis gas. We will not emphasize the need for the synthesis gas, but it is already known. We will little later show you a picture where from the synthesis gas almost all chemicals can be made. Now the coverage will be the thermodynamics, the temperature range of the reaction, catalyst systems, role of the components, active metal, support and promoter, and other relevant reactions. Later on we will also deal with the reactors, possible reactors. Here in this projection I have shown what is the situation with respect to the natural gas. I hope you are able to see natural gas. You can, from the natural gas you can get the syngas, from the syngas you can go to methanol, from methanol you can go to a variety of products, acetic acid, dimethyl ether, ethanol, MTBE, direct methanol fuel cell you can use because of the impurities will be less. You can take the synthesis gas, go into Fischer-Tropsch process or mixed alcohols or butenes and isobutenes, ethanol, hydrogen, aldehydes and ketones. The natural gas itself can give rise to a variety of chemicals. So therefore there is a variety of situations, but the point here is when I get the synthesis gas from the natural gas by reforming with the CO2, what we are worried about is the carbon monoxide hydrogen ratio. This ratio, if it were to be 1:1, then it is a feasible process. If it is more than 1:1, carbon monoxide 1 and hydrogen 2 or hydrogen 3, then you will be able to produce the hydrocarbons and other things. So therefore the ratio maintaining is an important parameter. Now quickly looking at the reactions, we will look at the reactions in the reforming of CO2 with methane only. We are now going to do that only, and this is an introduction lecture to that topic. We will be having few other lectures on this. Now what is the main aim of this carbon dioxide reforming? This is also called dry reforming. It is for the production of synthesis gas by the reaction of CO2 with hydrocarbons, especially methane. Okay, so synthesis gas is conventionally produced via the steam reforming of naphtha. This has relevance to the concern on the greenhouse gases to global warming, because we are both using carbon dioxide and methane, whereas in the conventional steam reforming it is using steam and naphtha. So since we are not using the steam, this process is called dry reforming. There is another process that is called TRI reforming, which we will be doing subsequently. It is in this method we are replacing steam as a reactant with the carbon dioxide. So the methane carbon dioxide reforming reaction is given here. CO2 plus methane giving rise to 2H2 and 2CO. I hope you are able to see we are producing 1:1 ratio of carbon monoxide and hydrogen. So now we have to understand a few things about this reaction. Okay, so here I have shown pictorially carbon dioxide and methane putting into a catalyst. It produces syngas. Once you have produced this syngas, what all you can produce is pictorially shown: aviation fuel, diesel and petrol, and all other things can be produced. So now what is the same thing is shown here: CO2 plus methane catalyst. What is this catalyst, how it has to be used, is what is going to be discussed here. It produces syngas. Now, since from the syngas, you can put it into the storage tanks or put it in the storage vessels, pressure vessels. Wow. It can be used in the transport sector, at automobiles, diesel engines, and aeroplanes. The picture, what is the picture shown here, is put in a problem in a words here. So now the relevant reactions that will take place in the CO2 reformation reaction is, this is the main reaction, methane plus carbon dioxide giving rise to 2CO plus 2H2. The free the enthalpy of the reaction and the entropy the free energy change of the reaction is given here, the two parameters. Now there are many other concurrent reactions. Now since we are methane plus water can give rise to carbon monoxide and hydrogen, and methane can also give rise to decompose to give rise to carbon and hydrogen, it all given here. Carbon monoxide that is formed can also disproportionate to give rise to carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide plus hydrogen can give rise to a variety of products. Carbon monoxide and hydrogen can give rise to carbon and water. The first figure in this, all the numbers that is given in the first figure, it refers to the delta H0 in kilojoules per mole. The second figure refers to the free energy change. So now if you have to look at it, this is the reaction number one is the steam reforming reaction. Now in the main reaction, the temperature range that we are talking about is around 650 to 640 to 650 degree centigrade or 913 degrees Kelvin. Now the main reaction giving rise to 1:1 mole ratio of carbon monoxide and hydrogen. Now attendant to that, we will be able to get methane cracking, that is the reaction number 3, which takes place at 820 to 830 degrees, is methane cracking reaction. Now if you look at the reaction 4, which is the reaction 4 is the carbon formation from carbon monoxide, and reaction 5 is the reverse of the water gas shift reaction. Okay, this is the water, this is CO, not CPO, it is CO plus H2O. CO plus H2O giving rise to CO2 plus H2, that is the gas, that is the water gas shift reaction. Here it is the reverse reaction, CO2 plus H2 giving rise to CO plus H2O. This water gas shift reaction, reverse water gas reaction, takes place around 820 degrees. So now the message that we are understanding here is that if I want to carry out the dry reforming of methane, I have to make sure that there is a limiting temperature for the different reactions. So essentially what we are getting the message here is, the temperature range that we have to use is between 830 to 973 degree Kelvin. Okay, this is temperature is important. Second parameter that we have to worry is the pressure of the CO2. Okay, people may think that increasing the CO2 will facilitate the reaction. That is not true, because the main reaction is not taking place very efficiently. The main reaction is the reforming of methane with CO2 to give rise to CO and H2. This reaction does not take place at high pressures of CO2. So therefore ambient pressure and very critical control of the temperature is required. Essentially if you look at it, high pressures, it is equivalent to excess of CO2. Therefore it means that I need to expend higher energy. So therefore that is what is the sequence of this. But the challenges, we are going to look at the challenges, we will look at it. So before that, on the catalyst surface, what are the possibilities, reactions that are taking place is the question. Now on the catalyst surface, I told you it is normally a metal supported metal catalyst or supported metal catalyst promoted with something. So now we have to identify what are the species that can be formed on the active sites of the catalyst surface. Here I have shown, assuming the metal site is the active site, what are the things that will happen. So here you can see on the metal site, the methane is activated to give rise to methyl radical, methylene radical, CH species and carbon, and finally the 2H, capital H, giving rise to hydrogen. These are the proposed reactions that are possible on the active metal sites. Now on the on the support. Okay, it, support can be anything, we will come to it. What are the types of supports that are possible? On the support, CO2 is getting absorbed as CO2 on the metal. The acidic supports promotes this reaction. CO2 goes to CO and O. CO metal goes to CO gas. That is the on acidic supports. On basic support, CO2 goes to the CO2 support. CO2 plus oxygen giving rise to CO3 radical, CO3 ion. The 2H gives rise to 2H on the support. The CO3 2 minus and 2H plus can give rise to bicarbonate, and then CO goes to the gas phase. So these are the possibilities. Now, what is the role of the promoter? Here I have shown in all these three slides that I have shown here, they are only telling you what are the essential reactions that will take place on the main components of the catalyst. You should not think that these are the only things that are taking place. So on the promoter, carbon monoxide gas goes to the carbon monoxide support and oxygen to the promoter. Oxygen promoter plus metal giving rise to carbon carbon monoxide gas phase. So now quickly looking at it, okay, here I have summarized all that literature. I will show you a little later the table. I have shown you what are the catalysts that are possible for this, okay. It can be an oxide, it can be metal, oxide on oxide supports, or metal on oxide supports, or metal on oxide supports, like that, okay. So therefore, we can see here nickel oxide supported on calcium oxide, or nickel oxide supported on cobalt oxide, magnesium oxide, or nickel oxide supported on magnesium, MgO. So the temperature range for the dry reforming reaction is 873 to 1123 in this. So what it means is the lower temperature is the first catalyst, the higher temperature is for the NiO, MgO catalyst. Okay, so conversion levels, I hope you are able to see, it is nearly 100% conversion. Okay, so here the conversion is given with respect to methane, it is not given with respect to CO2. So therefore, high selectivity of this syngas is formed, CO and H2E are formed. Ruthenium on SiO2, MgO, TiO2, the temperature range, we have already talked about this temperature range, the importance of the temperature range. You see, when I take such a noble metal, the conversion with respect to the reaction falls down to 35. This is because of the very high activity of the metal for the deactivation. The deactivation here is, we have to understand a few things. The deactivation here is due to the poisoning of the metal site or due to the coke formation. Okay, coke formation. In addition to that, since the temperature is high, it can also give rise to sintering of the catalyst. Okay. So therefore, all these things are possible. In addition to that, we will also be able to carry out few other reactions also. Since the temperatures are very high and we have a multi-component system, solid state reactions can take place, and therefore active components will be lost, or residual oxidation reactions can take place. So the next catalyst is cobalt on silica or magnesia silica. The temperature is 873. So conversion with respect to methane is about 46. This catalyst is better than nickel. Okay, I will show you all the data a little later. Iridium and alumina, 873. I already talked about it, why the temperature is so important. The higher temperatures means you will be carrying out the reverse water gas reaction and also the carbon deposition reaction. Okay, so therefore we have to be very careful about the temperature. So here one gets about 50% conversion. So the preparation. So now how these catalysts have been characterized. Okay, the total data that is available in literature I will show you subsequently. Here I am showing you only the extracted information. So monometallic supported catalyst, nickel on ceria, platinum on alumina, nickel on silica, ruthenium on silica, or iridium on alumina, they have characterized them XRD, TPR, XPS, EPR, TPO, and TP, that is temperature promoted hydrogenation. So essentially, what is the information they have looked for in this using this characterization technique is the metal dispersion, how the metal is dispersed on this is, whether the metal is easily reducible, whether the coke formation takes place or not. Now, bimetallic supported catalyst, example nickel cobalt or nickel rhodium on supports, variety of supports that is possible we have already seen. So the techniques that are used are XRF, XRD, XRF, XPS, TG, DTA and chemis option. So here, because the essentially it is a bimetallic case, we have to worry about the composition. In the moment we are saying composition, we have to see whether it is an alloy or not, what are the phases that are forming, coke and metal dispersion, all this information have been obtained. Metal oxide supported on catalyst, in the previous slide itself I showed you, this is also a catalyst, nickel oxide, calcium oxide, you should not think that it is a nickel, okay, metal oxide and metal oxide support, see cobalt oxide and magnesia, cobalt oxide and ceria, TPO, XRD, XPS, it is all the studies have been concentrated on the whether the catalyst is resistant to coke formation, because it is an oxide-oxide reaction, therefore whether the multiple oxides or compound oxides are formed or not, the phases have been identified. Now promoted supported catalyst on aluminum, for example nickel promoted by potassium, nickel promoted by tin, nickel promoted by calcium, nickel promoted by manganese on an alumina support, okay. Mostly alumina support is used in all these things, the TG, temperature program reduction, XRD, TEM, TPO, here also carbon formation, coke formation, active sites, reduction behavior is what is looked. Now a variety of perovskite catalysts also have been used, lanthanum nickelate, lanthanum nickel magnesium oxide, lanthanum nickel cobalt oxide, lanthanum strontium nickel oxide, lanthanum cerium nickel oxide, here also XRD, TPR, TPO, TEM, SEM, all temperature, all these techniques have been used, the information they have used or the aspects that they have studied is calcination temperature, structure, whether it is the structure is retained, phases are identical with the initial phase of the perovskite, reversibility and sintering, all these things. So this is the table from the literature, I hope you are able to see this reference. Since you cannot read this, that is why I have summarized it here, okay. This is the summary of this table. This is the total table giving rise to for nickel on calcium oxide and nickel on variety of supports you can see, on which the composition of the ratio of carbon methane to carbon dioxide and the conversion of methane, the conversion of CO2 and the coke formation takes place or not, all the informations are given here. So in the same way, here I have given, this is the summary of this, this is the data, the actual data is, because it is not very clear, so I have not shown here what are the techniques that have been used. So here the characterization I have already summarized in this table. So therefore the main essentially what they are looking for is looking for the whether the carbon dioxide coke formation takes place or not, reverse water gas reaction is taking place or not. So now I have summarized here, okay, the types of support oxides that can be used. Basic oxide, I hope you are able to see all the basic oxides that are possible, magnesium oxide, calcium oxide, barium oxide, amphoteric oxides, neutral oxides, aluminium, magnesium aluminate, magnesium chromate, magnesium zinc chromate, alumina and calcium silicate. There are acidic supports, mainly gamma alumina, I hope you are able to see. There are various reasons why gamma alumina is used, because that is what gives the highest surface area, that is why it is used. So here the characteristics of this are given. I do not know whether you understand this or not, why Huttig temperature and Tamman temperature, I have already talked about it a number of times. The melting point, then this will be 2/3 of the melting point, that is what is 1536. I hope you are able to see approximately 50%. So these are the Huttig temperature is the starting point of the sintering, and the Tamman temperature is definitely sintering takes place. So therefore you can see that all these parameters have to be used carefully, because our reaction has to be taking place around 640 degrees centigrade or around 823 degrees Kelvin. So the studies that have been done, forget about this slide, what is has been done is to study the reaction fitting into a variety of equations, adsorption, surface reaction and the rate of the reaction is what is the net reaction that is controlled. So now if we were to look at the factors like addition of copper to support a nickel system, surface geometry, electronic structure, the extent of CH2 species, hydrogen spillover contribute to the nickel copper supported system in CO2. I have taken only one or two typical examples. We are going to see in the subsequent lectures all the other catalysts. So now they have varied the copper content. This is it. I told you, I hope you are remembering that we saw a bimetallic catalyst. Okay, bimetallic catalyst, bimetallic supported catalyst we saw, nickel cobalt, nickel rhodium, nickel copper, all those things are bimetallic catalyst. These bimetallic catalyst here in the case, nickel silica system is taken and added 1% to 8% of copper. So this is a bimetallic system of nickel copper system and SiO2. The stability is greater, up to greater than 760 degrees. Therefore, the temperature is very very suitable for the dry reforming reaction. The active site here, the active site is nickel, but the active site is stabilized by the presence of copper, so that it does not undergo the oxidation. Carbon formation same as nickel. Okay, nickel. If I have only nickel silica catalyst and copper in nickel catalyst, the carbon formation is more or less same. Therefore, it is not a bad catalyst. Copper nickel species inhibit the carbon formation. Copper addition promotes methane cracking, and the inactive coke does not accumulate on copper nickel catalyst. So this is the work that was reported in this paper. So therefore, essentially what we are worrying about is we are only looking at the thermodynamics, which is not favoring carbon formation, so that we will be able to get synthesis gas CO and H2. If carbon is formed, then it is not giving rise to this the selectivity. Selectivity is for CO and H2. So normally, what is the situation is the we have already seen, when I take nickel, the carbon formation is alleviated, and if I take nickel and put copper small amount 1%, it is alleviate still carbon formation. The same way, noble metals also will be facilitating hydrogen evolution. Therefore, they will not give rise to the carbon formation. So this is the crux of the issue. Now, in the case of the what is the situation with respect to a variety of the catalysts? Okay, so now there I told you that the optimum composition of the feed has to be CO2 to methane is 1:1. Okay, I hope you are able to see all of them are 1:1. So the conversion levels that we are worrying is it should be at least 70-80%. It should not be less than that. And I have already talked to you that the temperature has to be 873 or something like that. If you go a little higher, then the reverse water gas shift reaction or the carbon formation reactions will take place. Unless otherwise, the catalyst is capable of resisting carbon formation. So in those catalysts where the carbon formation is resisting, then only we can go to higher temperatures. Otherwise, we cannot go to higher temperatures. So nickel alumina, you can see palladium alumina, all those things, ruthenium alumina, all those things. The only situation is that only these catalysts are capable of giving rise to the conversions which we are desiring. Okay, conversions is has to be more than 80%, 14%, 29%. These are all not a good situation. So the catalytic reforming of CO2 to methane with 1:1 mixture on various catalysts collected from literature here. So I have shown, I hope you are able to see here, this is the summary of all the results which you are giving. So nickel on NaY and nickel on silica, if you take, you see nickel on NaY gives me 15% conversion, nickel on silica gives me 85% conversion. The temperature is very highly suitable for us. It avoids the reverse water gas reaction, carbon formation. Palladium on NaY, alumina and thing, you can see 29, and alumina it is 70-75, and magnesia 84. The temperatures are like this, and the alumina the temperature has to be higher, and the magnesia 963, and sodium Y 873. Platinum on NaY and MgO is 873 and 963. Rhodium and titanium silica and alumina it is 88-585. So silica is not a good support for rhodium, because it forms rhodium silicate. Nickel alumina, like that, if you look at it, this very, as I told you, nickel is one of the best catalysts. We are going to see in the subsequent presentations on the what are the results that are available. So the temperature is not favorable, 1050 and 1273. ruthenium alumina, europium oxide and magnesium oxide also is good, but it's very low, 60 to 90%, temperatures are not very good. Iridium and europium oxide and aluminium oxide 80 degree and 88 and 85 good, 1000 degrees and 1050. So now looking at a variety of other, I hope you saw this table, this is a summary of that table, okay. Here if you look at it, we are taking cobalt, nickel, rhodium, all the other catalysts. So here you can see that in the nickel alumina, nickel magnesium, nickel calcium oxide or mixed oxide, titanium dioxide alumina, we can change the feed composition. We can go methane more and carbon dioxide less, okay. As I told you, increasing the carbon dioxide is not a good solution. Carbon dioxide has to be one, okay. But in all these catalysts, you will see that the conversion is very high, more than 80%. Okay, so therefore, it appears to be that if dry reforming of methane has to be done, one has to choose the catalyst in this range. Now, here I have taken the activity of systems to summarize this whole thing. Alumina, if I take alumina, rhodium, palladium, ruthenium, platinum and iridium, I hope the activity order is very clearly seen, okay. Now it is 1 weight percent loading. If it is were to be 0.5 to 1% loading, then the order activity is more or less maintained, but it is slightly different. I hope you are able to see. So now if I were to take, instead of the noble metals, we have to take the conventional metals, nickel, cobalt and iron, I have to put a very high loading of the metal. But the temperatures, I hope you are always looking at the temperatures, they have to be less than 850 degree Kelvin, the 850 degree Kelvin. So now if I were to take silica, what is the situation? Let us take only the noble metals, ruthenium, rhodium, nickel and palladium, and palladium 1 weight percent. If I were to change it to 0.5%, this is the order. Magnesium oxide, which is a basic oxide, we saw acidic oxide, basic oxide, rhodium, ruthenium, iridium, palladium and platinum. The same way europium oxide also is given, sodium Y is given, which is a basic oxide. So now taking the reverse situation, take ruthenium, take three supports. In the previous slide I was showing you support various metals. Now I am taking the same metal, put various supports, alumina, titania, silica. Now you can see alumina, ruthenium and alumina is better than ruthenium and silica, titania, ruthenium and silica. So you can see metal loading is 0.5, which is very good, but the activity has to be only on alumina, okay. Now palladium, you take titanium dioxide, vanadium, aluminium oxide, sodium Y, silica, magnesia, sodium ZSM 5, but the metal loading has to be very high. The same way, rhodium on Y is that yttria stabilizer, zirconia, alumina, titania, silica, magnesia, 0.5% is there, the temperature has to be little higher. Now the nickel, which is very important for us, we are going to look at it little later or next classes. Nickel on alumina and silica, I have already told you, on alumina and silica are the only good support for the nickel system. So, but the nickel loading has to be very high, okay, 10% to 48%. Okay, you can also put on sodium I, Y, but 2 weight percent is enough, but the temperatures are very good for the nickel catalyst. That is why people are worrying about nickel catalyst. So now what will happen if I take this catalyst, okay, nickel, since we are looking at the nickel, we will look at nickel, zirconia and titania. Now if I were to take this catalyst and treat it in helium, okay, I hope you are able to see the picture here shown, but anyway we will not worry about the picture. What it means is, if the catalyst is treated, heated in the helium atmosphere, then the active sites are very distributed on the surface and the activity is higher, okay. I hope you are able to see the activity of the helium prepared system is higher than with the hydrogen treated or methane treated or carbon monoxide treated catalyst. Okay, same thing is shown here. Now heterogeneity of the nickel sites on hydrogen treatment is increasing. CO treatment of carbon covered metallic sites, therefore deactivation takes place. So this is the essential result of the nickel catalyst. Okay, keep these points in mind. We are going to look at all these things in the subsequent lectures. Cobalt containing reforming catalyst. Now what is happening? Cobalt containing promoted by noble metal palladium. Okay, cobalt and palladium and alumina. I have already talked to you. Alumina and silica are the good support for this reaction with respect to activity and selectivity, resistance to carbon formation. Cobalt, palladium, alumina depend on composition and process conditions, because what is the amount of cobalt, what is the amount of palladium? We have already shown it that the copper, in the case of copper nickel catalyst, we have shown 1 to 9% is the only maximum that you can put. Now if I change this, the instead of producing me synthesis gas, we will be producing oxygenates, so which is no use for us. Now CO2 reforming over nickel alumina catalyst. Nickel alumina promoted by carbon, copper, zirconium, manganese, molybdenum, titanium and silver and tin. That is all done here. I hope you are able to see the message that we are getting from the result. Okay, we will not worry about the result. The message that we are getting is, if I were to take nickel catalyst, promote it with the copper, cobalt and zirconium, improved for the selectivity to CO formation. Okay, I hope you are able to see the selectivity formation. Now manganese, I hope you are able to see, manganese reduces the carbon formation. I hope you are able to see manganese formation, carbon formation is reduced, coke formation is given here in the last column. So now this is the same thing that I have shown him before in a different 3 or 4 slides. What are the catalyst component and corresponding reaction, proposed reaction mechanism. So we have to worry about all these steps before we design a catalyst for the catalytic dry reforming of methane. Okay, this is exactly what I have done here. Okay, I hope you are remembering this. These three slides are shown in a single slide here to make sure that we remember. Keep in mind the reactions that will take place. The reactions that will take place on the metal surface, on the support and the promoter. Why these are all the we are worried about is, when we use the support, there can be spillover, there can be other effects that will be there. So we have to worry about this. So now the process that is occurring, okay, we are going to see this in the next lecture, is whether we have to use a conventional reactor, whether we have to use a membrane reactor, all those things we have to worry about it. But what we are talking about is the input is methane and carbon dioxide. So therefore what we are interested in is carbon monoxide and hydrogen. We don't want this type of reactions. So therefore, but the concurrently, if I were to have air, the air oxidations will take place. So that is why we have to worry about all these things. So ultimately what we want is only carbon monoxide and hydrogen. So this is what is the situation as far as the dry reforming of methane in presence of CO2. So the essential issues or the challenges that we are facing are the poisoning of the catalyst and carbon formation, sintering of the catalyst, solid state reactions that will take place and the concurrent residual oxidation reactions. Now the main reactions that will take place are the methane plus carbon dioxide giving rise to carbon monoxide and hydrogen, but methane can crack to give rise to carbon and hydrogen, carbon monoxide formed and also give rise to Bodart reaction, CO2 giving rise to CO2 plus C. Now on all the metal catalysts, the morphology and structure, when we say morphology and structure, the size also is important. So for example, the critical size for the nickel particles have to be less than 10 nanometers. The surface defects can facilitate carbon formation. Steps and kinks also favor this. Therefore, we have to avoid these things as far as the carbon formation is concerned. The promoter enhances the adsorption of CO2, enhances the surface reaction, decreases the rate and degree of methane activation and dissociation. Support well-defined structure like ABO3, that is the perovskites or spinels, and form strong interaction with the active metal. Others form solid solutions or alloys when I use the multi-component systems. Therefore, we have to be essentially looking at what is happening in all these catalysts when we put them in the active phases. So when we are interested in dispersing this catalyst, we have to use we have already seen this in number of times. You use sulfur or boron to cover part of the site. Special structures like spinel is promoting the dispersion. Some inactive species cover some of the sites formed in reduction, like VOX in V2O5, TOX in titanium dioxide, MOX in MnO2. Add some promoter to disperse the sites. So control the size with the special structure, and encapsulation is required. So this is the essentially what we have seen today is that the dry reforming of methane with the CO2 to produce synthesis gas. Once you have the synthesis gas, you will be able to get any of the compounds that you want. So therefore, the temperature of the reaction is important, and also the catalyst and the catalyst support, catalyst promoter are important. These are the aspects that we will be dealing with in the next class.